it's Michael from Red Chair Diaries coming to you from my library. No, this is not my library. This is next to my library. This is my home office slash study in Nova Scotia, Canada. And it is July 2nd, 2017. It's the day after our national holiday, pardon me, Canada Day, celebrating 150 years since the Confederation of Canada was born. And even though the Indigenous peoples were here for thousands of years, and it seems you do have to mention that all the time now. And I mean, there's certainly truth to that, of course. But as far as the founding of the country of Canada with the English and French forebears, it's 150 years since the amalgamation of the different provinces. Anyway, it's July 2nd now. We've had very bad weather for this long weekend. We had downpours, incredible downpours yesterday, today. Ted and I did go downtown to have a nice lunch and be part of the festivities, but it was quite a mess for the most part, but people's spirits were still high. Anyway, I'm going to talk about the Foresyte Saga. This is volume 9 that I just finished today. And I'll be showing you those books, the towering pile of books that I have, and the series, the Foresyte Saga. 26 black and white episodes, the late 1960s. Probably my favorite series of all time, and that would even trump, God, I hate even using that word, trump my love for Star Trek, the original series. So that's my favorite science fiction. This is my favorite family saga. And I just wanted to talk about it. I don't, as I say, I have another piece where I show the some of the books and the DVD set. As done 50 years ago, they were photographing it. They were filming it in 1966 and 1967. And it was being rolled out in England before they even finished filming it. So it was getting, I remember reading about it and seeing a bit of a documentary about it, though I saw it a couple of years after it was in England. CBC put it on in Canada. But, and I was in grade 12, I guess, when I saw it, 11 or 12, before I went to university. And the fame started before they finished filming it, right? You know, but it was, it or is possibly one of the most popular series of all time, I would think, from the BBC. And it's famous around the world, and it's based on 6 of the 9 novels in the Foresyte Chronicles, which, as I said, I just finished reading today. So I finally got around to reading the 9 novels, primarily the first 6 are what was photographed. And I've had them, I physically have had them for 41 years, and I finally got around to reading them. So I don't throw my books out. And as somebody who's not working now, I've ostensibly retired. I may go back and do some part-time work. I haven't completely ruled that out. I've got more time for reading, which is something I've always wanted to have. And so for me to read those nine books in 1 month and still read other things and still have a bit of a life and do housework and things like this, it's a pretty good accomplishment. I'm very pleased about it. But the books, the first one was published in 1906 and the last one was published in 1934. And John Galsworthy died, I think the little bio page says, in 1933 or 1934. And I think it said he got the Nobel Prize for Literature in 1933. So these books are really, really good, and they move along like this. They go at a fast pace. They are very droll. They're not laugh out loud funny terribly. They're not Nancy Mitford type books. They're not Jeeves and Wooster. The first 6 are completely about the moneyed classes, the Foresytes. And the last 3 are about a couple of the Foresytes, but mostly about more poverty, less well off people with titles. You know, they still don't manage to have subservience. So the last trilogy isn't really about too many rich people, but the themes are the same about searching for love and trying to exist as certain societal mores are dying. The books take into account the fact that World War I changed society in England utterly, really. You know, I mean, it's not long after World War I that the Edwardian dress was gone and the flapper short dresses came in and things like this. And not just the hemlines and the stiff collars loosened up, society loosened up, but there's still a strain that, you know, the younger people are fighting against. And that's what a lot of the books are about. So you've got the two main characters in the first three novels really are Soames Forsyte. He's the so-called man of property. He knows the cost of everything, in some cases the value of nothing. And he's also an art collector, and he's a solicitor. And he is absolutely smitten with Irene. It's spelled Irene, but it's pronounced, at least on the TV show, Irene, with three syllables. Heron, H-E-R-O-N. And she's basically about art and beauty and piano and Chopin and all of that. And he becomes enraptured with her, and he must possess her. And after wooing her, and her situation is so precarious when it comes to money and her stepmother's remarrying and all of that, that she finally accepts the offer on the promise that if it doesn't work out, basically, you know, and she wants to leave, that he'll let her go. And of course he agrees. And of course, when it doesn't work out and she falls in love with somebody else and all this tragedy comes from that, and he never lets her go, you know, so it takes a lot of books. Anyway, that's basically the first three books with his cousin, who is the complete antithesis of Soames, Jolyon. The names are unbelievable. So J-O-L-Y-O-N. He is all about life and art as well, and leaves his austere, well-to-do life and has a mistress, and then leaves his wife and his daughter, and because he just had to be free. So you've got these two who don't like each other because what they see in the other person is what they are not. And in some ways, there are elements that they covet in their cousin, right? And man alive, you know, all the trials and tribulations. And then you've got Soames' parents, you've got Soames' sister, Winifred, her shitty husband, you know, who can't be trusted. And one thing after another, and the characters are unbelievably well-rendered, realistic, you know, they're terrific. Anyway, I don't want to give too much of the plot away because you might want to get them. And you can get all nine novels for $1.99. on Kindle and Kobo. Just keep searching. Just do Forsyte Chronicles and make sure you've got the nine and not the six. Though you might read the six and not do the last three. But man, they're worth it. They're just so interesting that books published, some of them published over 100 years ago, they're so current. And then you get all the politics and the basically the Forsytes are in the top 5%, say, you know, of wealth, and then you've got the poverty, the lower classes, and the maids. It's not upstairs, downstairs. It's they don't concentrate in that way on that. It's about the upstairs, really. But it's so interesting and so current. And John Galsworthy himself was trained as a lawyer, a solicitor, though he didn't take on too many cases. So he goes into this whole thing about Irene trying to have a divorce, you know, trying to sever her relationship with Soames, and she's got society is against her because she would have to be the adulteress. That's what it was like in the old days. That's what it was like in the States and Canada until a few decades ago. Somebody had to be caught in bed with somebody who was not their spouse in order to have grounds for a divorce. So you've got all of those issues, and who's going to get involved with who. Then in the second trilogy, the modern comedy, you've got Soames finally gets remarried. I said, there I am giving it away, but if you know anything about Soames, the Forsyte Saga, a small description of it will give it away. But you've got, so he has a second wife, and he has his daughter Fleur, and he, of course, he wanted his son to carry on the Forsyte name. So, of course, he ends up with a daughter, and she is the love of his life, and she doesn't know the secret that he forced himself upon his wife, even though she wanted a divorce, you know, and all of this. And it takes books for her to find out all of this out. But she falls in love with Jolien's youngest son that he had with Irene when she wasn't even free at that point, I guess. Maybe she was. I don't even know. I don't even remember. So you've got the cousins again getting involved, and all of the sadness that comes from that. So that's the second set, basically. And she's, boy, she wants what she wants. She's from the, she was born, in her character's born in the early part of the 20th century, and she is absolutely a flapper. You know, she wants what she wants. And a lot of angst comes from that for the different generations. And I think I could just leave that there. The first set, you've got the Boer War and the Crimean War. The second set, you've got the First World War. But the author died before he could get to the Second World War. But I think he's predicted it in those books. If you actually read it closely, it sounds like he knew it was coming. The third trilogy branches off into cousins of Fleur's, and you end up with Dinny, D-I-N-N-Y. And I already forget her formal name, but she's called Dinny. And her sister Claire, and all the different uncles and brothers. So the first book, Maiden Waiting of that trilogy, is about one of Dinny's brothers is in trouble because he's accused of doing something bad in Bolivia, where he was working for a private firm, and then was supposedly whipping the natives, so to speak, and was left. There was some kind of altercation with guns, and somebody died, and all of this. And then this comes to haunt him in England, but he was left in the lurch by somebody, and so that's what is happening. And there's a court case involved in that. Or at least some action is taken in that. And that's the book. Then in the second one, Dinny's in love with somebody, a poet who was in one of the first novels that was in love with Fleur in book four. So you've got all of that. So that's basically about Dinny, the second book, and her love. And then the third book is about Claire. The final book, the One More River, is about Sister Claire trying to get rid of her husband, who was a sadist. So she comes back from Ceylon, which is Sri Lanka now. And then all the court issue about, you know, was she an adulteress? There's a fellow on the boat that's in love with her when she's on her way back, and you know, did they commit adultery? And then there's a big court case, and everybody sued, and all of this. So that's the third book. So it sounds dull as dishwater, doesn't it? It really does. And it isn't. It's very, very interesting. I mean, I'm not so sure it's for somebody who's playing video games and is out there doing this. That you know, they would probably die within the first three chapters of the series. But maybe if you've got a few years on yourself and you've been in love, you haven't been in love, you've been ditched, you ditched someone. You know, you understand something about the law. You understand something about the government and legalities and parliament and all of this. I think that you'd find it fascinating, and also about obsession. You know, obsession with somebody who doesn't want you. It's very painful. I mean, I remember as a young lad after I came out, you know, when I would fall very, 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 very strongly, you know, and end up with these obsessions that I had to work myself out of, right? Because, you know, you want what you want and you can't always have it. And then you have to be sensible. You know, you don't want to turn into one of those people that are on those TV shows, you know. You let it go, right? You have to find some maturity in situations like that. So all of that sort of behavior, it's in the books. And they're fascinating, and they're so well written. And like I say, so droll, you know, the observations about people's behavior is wonderful. And if you've ever been to London, for those of us who don't live over there, but I've been there four times, I think, now, you know, you can recognize the neighborhoods that they're talking about. And that's always a kick when if you're reading a book and you can actually say, oh, yeah, I went down that street, or I went to that pub is still in existence and things like that. And that's fun in and of itself, you know. Anyway, I just want to go through that. And that's it. So I've got a few more details on the second part of this. So it's going to take about 21 minutes, but I hope you enjoy it. Anyway, it's Michael from Red Chair Diaries, and I will see you around the tube. The Foresyte Saga. Or should I say, The Foresyte Chronicles by John Galsworthy. The first three books from the bottom up, The Man of Property, In Chancery, and To Let. The second trio is The White Monkey, The Silver Spoon, Swan Song. They are grouped as a trilogy called The Modern Comedy. And the final trilogy is Maiden Waiting, Flowering Wilderness, One More River. I just finished that today, One More River. And that is called End of the Chapter. That trio is called End of the Chapter. The first three concern basically Soames, Forsyte, his wife Irene, Soames' cousin Jolyon, and their offspring. The second trilogy is still Soames and his second wife and his daughter Fleur. And different comings and goings and liaisons. And then the third trilogy, End of the Chapter, actually only has Fleur Forsyte and her husband Michael Mont as peripheral characters, and then some of their cousins. So it's not really the Forsyte Chronicles anymore, but they're still grouped because they're still linked, but it really is a standalone series. And then I'll talk a bit more about them, but I wanted to show them to you. And I've showed them in videos or Instagram, I should say, the different pictures, the different covers. And I've had these since September 1976. I only paid $1 for each of them. They're on discount at a chain that in Canada called Cole's Bookstore. Bought them in Halifax before I moved to Vancouver. And that was the first time I moved to Vancouver. And I lived out there for 28 years, starting in 1979. And they went with me, and they've come back, and only one of them has some damage to some of the pages. They're in pretty good shape. And then we have this BBC series that I bought. I first saw it on TV in 1967, 68 or 69. It was the end of the 60s, and it really was set up the American PBS. It wasn't called PBS in those days, but it's a BBC series, one of the most popular ever. I'm trying to get this figured out here. And I got this about 12 or 13 years ago. I've always wanted it and was finally able to get it on DVD. And it's the last black and white series that BBC did, the last black and white large saga. And 26 episodes. And it takes into account the first six books. It doesn't take into account end of the chapter. So it really, and then they called it the Forsyte Saga, not the Forsyte Chronicles. And it's a fantastic show. It may be too slow for today's younger audience, used to, you know, quick cuts and things. But no, these are extended dialogue scenes shot on videotape, black and white, all in the studio, with actors of incredible talent. But as in many other series in those days, the actors are much too old for the real characters. I know this is a mess. Like these characters here, this is when they're actually older. This is Jolyon Forsyte to the left and Irene Heron Forsyte to the right. And she's playing older than she is then. He may still be playing younger, I'm not sure. But in the show, they start out and she's only 19, supposedly. Now, you know, she certainly wasn't 19 when she was acting. And he was supposed to be like 35 or something. So it all, you know, that all gets a bit silly. But that's the way it is. Oh, too much. I can't find all the pictures for you. Let me see. I started watching it again. I mean, I've seen it three times. I've seen it twice on TV, at least twice on TV, I think, and once on DVD. So I'm on to the fourth. So that doesn't quite work. Yeah, so here's the other main character. That's Eric Porter as Soames Forsyte. He's in the first six books. So he's in all 26 shows. And that's he wooing Irene when she's about 19. And he's supposed to be either in his 20s or early 30s. And, you know, and he's certainly much older. But, man, what a performance. And this whole show was redone, you know. Actually, not the whole show. There was a revamping of it, I think, in 2002 with a wonderful group of actors, but it could not hold a candle to the original. It just couldn't. And even though one of my favorites, Rupert Graves, was playing.
I can't connect at the moment.
Jolyon. I'm not trying to connect, stupid Cortana. Get the hell out of here. Anyway, I'm going to go talk about it somewhere. I want to show you some of those pictures, okay? See you soon.